In earlier lectures, first two lectures, we have discussed the basic history of this atomic physics. So what were the steps that were followed by different people in scientists, basically physicists, who came to this particular model of atom. So as we have seen, how hundreds of years of history is there behind this assumption or concept of this matter particle, basically called as atoms. Then in the first inquiry was done by, as I said earlier, this was done by, just a minute, by Rutherford. So we have seen this Rutherford model. Before that we have seen this plum pudding model kept by the Mr. Thomson, J.J. Thomson. So this model was further modified by Rutherford, and on the basis of his experiment, very famous experiment, Rutherford alpha particle scattering experiment. On the basis of that, Rutherford showed that most of the positive charges in an atom, they are concentrated in a very small region, whereas mass of the atom is also found to be in a very small region, and that particular region he called to be nucleus, and electrons are around that nucleus. So that was the picture put forth by Rutherford. So his accurate calculations of this nuclear radii for different elements, that was one of the noteworthy experiment, and that experiment led further scientists to revise or modify this theory of atom. And there comes one very important person, or name of that person, that is Niels Bohr, British scientist, who for the first time put this atomic model or his atomic model with certain assumptions and all these things. Now in today's discussion we are going to discuss all these assumptions one by one. Nuclear first assumption, second and third assumption, three assumptions are there. Based upon that he could calculate what is the velocity of electron that is revolving in a first orbit, second orbit, third orbit, as well as what do you mean by first orbit, second orbit. All these are the stationary orbits, and thereby for all such stationary orbits we can calculate their radii. So radius of first orbit, n is equal to 1, that is called as principal quantum number, n equal to 2, 3, 4, etc. And once we understood this concept of stationary orbit and their radii and their velocity, etc., as well as we can go for calculation of the energy. Here also this energy is found to be in a bound state, because the negative total energy is, in this case, kinetic plus potential comes to be negative, that's why it is again a bound state. And one more assumption, the third assumption basically put forth by this Bohr, that assumption help us why different type of spectral lines or spectrum or energies liberated or given by certain elements, and what is the basic physical phenomenon responsible for this type of emission of radiation or absorption of radiation in the form. And again, so this particular discovery was done in made by Bohr in 1931, okay, 107 year before. And at the same time there was a quantum principle put forth by Max Planck. That particular quantum principle came to help for this Bohr to put the second and third postulate of his theory. So all these three postulates led to a very profound theory of hydrogen atom, and thereby Bohr could explain theoretically existence of all such spectrum. Basically I think you have already done this particular type of spectrums, that is Balmer series. There are several different series are possible, bracket series, Fund series, Paschen series, etc. Why these series are possible, what is the wave number or the reciprocal of this wavelength of that particular type of radiation, as well as there is a one concept of Rydberg constant. So all these concepts which were known to physicists as well as spectroscopics earlier, these concepts could be given the explanation by this theory. That's why this Bohr theory is one of the most successful theory of the hydrogen atom. Almost all physical and chemical properties of hydrogen atom can be predicted once we understand this Bohr theory. So in that sense, Bohr theory is one of the very important, we can call it to be a milestone, which has started the discovery of an atom. So this theory quite successful in the hydrogen, but in higher atoms this particular model or Bohr model doesn't give that correct picture. So we have to modify it again. So there comes a Sommerfeld Bohr model. After the Sommerfeld model we go for this vector atom model with some more details, and that vector atom model is quite successful in explaining the structure of an atom. or whatever electronic configuration we write, 1s2, 2s2, 2p6, etc., why this comes there, why that way only, and once we write electronic configuration for any of the element, then how to predict its different properties, its spectrum, its chemical properties, its physical properties, etc., as well as its location in the periodic table. All these things can be understood very easily once we understand this vector atom model. So in today's discussion, we are going to concentrate on this Bohr atomic model and its all other characteristics. Okay, so in the beginning, we have to just write in very brief, and then we'll go for this postulates and all these things. Okay, so let's write in brief. Bohr modified, B-O-H-R, it is not B-H-O-R, okay, B-O-H-R, Bohr modified. Modified the Rutherford's model, Rutherford atom model. Bohr modified the Rutherford atom model using Planck's quantum theory. Planck's quantum theory. We are going to discuss in detail how this happened or how Bohr used this Planck's quantum conditions and etc. Planck's quantum theory of radiation. So he modified the Rutherford atom model by using Planck's quantum theory of radiation. According to him, a single electron revolves around a nucleus. Okay, later on we are going to call it to be a proton, single proton, a nucleus in the stationary orbit. So first time we are using this word here again, stationary orbits. Okay, so we are going to understand meaning of this word stationary orbit. Okay, and here we are, this Planck's theory shows that the amount of energy radiated, this is given by E is equal to h nu, where this h is the Planck's constant, and this is Planck's constant, its value may be known to you. This is 6.662 into 10⁻¹⁴ joules second. Okay, joules second, this is the unit of this h, and this nu is the frequency, and E is the energy of that particular radiation that is measured. So this particular formula we are going to use in all detail in this particular Fourier theory. So this is called as a photon of energy E. So relation of the photon of energy E and its frequency. Okay, so now frequency is related to wavelength, so it is wave property, and we are calling this photon to be a particle. So this is again a wave particle duality. So whatever quantum physics that was going at that time, that again helped a lot many things. So here we have assumed this photon to be particles, and their energy is given by this formula, E is equal to h nu. So this fundamental relation we are going to use here, that is called to be equation number one. Okay, so this is what photons concept. This is what quantum theory. Okay, Planck's quantum theory. This is Planck's quantum theory. Okay, remember why I am taking all these things in so detail, because being a physics graduate, we must know all the smaller details related to the atoms, related to the other their properties, materials, and so many things, because that helps you a lot when we go for understanding different types of other branches of physics too. So that's why we are going to go into details of that. Okay, now there are three postulates. So first postulate of Bohr theory, first postulate, that is assumption. So that was first is I'll write this. Electron revolves in a certain सर्क्यूलर, सर्क्यूलर अलाउड ऑर्बिट्स, अलाउड ऑर्बिट्स, ओके, दिस इज सर्टन सर्क्यूलर अलाउड ऑर्बिट्स अबाउट द न्यूक्लियस, अराउंड द न्यूक्लियस, अबाउट द न्यूक्लियस, न्यूक्लियस अंडर द एक्शन ऑफ, अंडर द एक्शन, ओके, वर्ड टू वर्ड, देर कैन बी सेवरल क्वेश्चन ओवर दिस प्लेटफॉर्म, अंडर द एक्शन ऑफ कूलॉम फोर्स, COULOMBS, कूलॉम्स फोर्स, दिस इज द वर्डिंग ऑफ दिस फर्स्ट पॉस्टुलेट. सो इलेक्ट्रॉन्स इन एन एटम रिवॉल्व अराउंड इन सर्टन अलाउड सर्क्यूलर ऑर्बिट्स अबाउट द न्यूक्लियस अंडर द एक्शन ऑफ द फोर्स, ओके, एंड नॉट दैट द फोर्स ऑफ अट्रैक्शन, द फोर्स ऑफ अट्रैक्शन. अगेन आई ड्रॉ दिस सिंपल पिक्चर वॉट वी ड्रॉन यस्टरडे. दिस इज माई न्यूक्लियस जेड ई प्लस एंड एट ए डिस्टेंस ऑफ आर सर्कल, दिस इज द आर, दिस इज एन इलेक्ट्रॉन विच इज रिवॉल्विंग, दिस इज वी मास ई एंड दिस इज ई माइनस, इलेक्ट्रॉन इज रिवॉल्विंग लाइक दिस, सो आर इज द डिस्टेंस बिटवीन देम टू. सो दिस जेड ई प्लस इज द चार्ज ऑफ द न्यूक्लियस, E minus is the charge of the electron, and therefore this force of attraction is given by capital F is equal to one of, this is Coulomb's law I'm using here, 4 pi epsilon 0 into Z times E square, okay, Z is the, ZE is the charge of the proton or the nucleus, E is the charge of the electron, and therefore ZE square is this even E2, so product even E2 is this. So Z is square upon R square, where R is the separation or the distance between them. This is what my equation 2. This is my equation number 2. Okay, so here we can write where the small r is the distance, distance between electron and proton or nucleus. Don't call it to be proton, because till then, until this Bohr put forth his theory, concept of proton was not known there. So proton was not known there. It was just known that there is a positive charge, but people were not calling it to be proton. Electron, they may have given name to this to be a proton. Okay, so Z is atomic number, atomic number, okay, and that is equal to 1 here. In case of hydrogen atom, this Z is equal to 1, and epsilon 0 is permittivity, permittivity, TTI, VT of vacuum or free space. This is said to be permittivity of the free space. Now, 4 pi is constant, 4 pi is constant, everything is known to us. And remember, this force of attraction. Now, again, yesterday we have seen this concept. The stability arises. So if there is only attraction, then definitely this electron is going to fall on this nucleus or going to get attracted on the nucleus. But this doesn't happen because of there is a certain centripetal force. That force pulls the electron away from the nucleus. Whereas this attraction force pulls the electron inside the nucleus, towards the nucleus. So there is constant war between these two forces. One is attractive force and one is repulsive force because of the centripetal motion or the circular motion. So these two forces must balance, then and then there will be a stability of the nucleus, otherwise this atom. So atom won't be stable if any of the forces more than the other. So this doesn't happen. That's why we can equate these two forces as follow. Okay, so right here, this attractive force must be equal to the centripetal force because of circular motion, which is given by mv square. Okay, so this fc, centripetal force, is given by mv square upon r. This is the formula, classical result or classical relation for this centrifugal force which is given by mv square upon r. Okay, and therefore for equilibrium condition or stable condition, for equilibrium condition, equilibrium condition, that means for the stability of the nucleus, we must have this F and FC should be equal. Therefore I can write mv square upon r is equal to 1 upon 4 pi epsilon 0, this is what Coulomb's law we have written earlier, into ze square upon r square. And rearrange this, we will get relation for this v square. Therefore v square, velocity square, okay, m is to be taken, one of the r will be cancelled and 4 pi epsilon 0 m will be there. So it is z into e square upon 4 pi epsilon 0 into m multiplied by r. Call this to be equation number 3. So v square is given to be 1 upon 4 pi epsilon 0 z e square upon m into r. So according to this first postulate, velocity of the electron in this first orbit is given by v square is equal to z is the atomic number of the nucleus, that is hydrogen, is equal to 1. E is the charge of the electron, square of that, 4 pi epsilon 0, that is the free permittivity of the free space. M is mass of that electron and r is its radius. So velocity and radius, they are connected by this equation 3. This was my first postulate. Then second postulate. Okay, second postulate. Remember, all these postulates are very very important and fundamental to understand this entire theory. Okay, now I have just, in the first postulate I have showed, I have mentioned, we have mentioned that the certain circular orbits are allowed. Now here we are using the quantum condition, which circular orbits, certain circular orbits are allowed, because those orbits have to satisfy some quantum conditions, and that is that condition is the angular momentum. So angular momentum of that orbits, or if electron is revolving in that particular orbits, its angular momentum must be equal to an integral multiple of h cross. H is the Planck's constant, again quantum condition is there. So this h cross means h upon twice pi. If I have a angle, if an electron is moving in a certain particular orbit and if its angular momentum is calculated, if it is equal to n into h cross, then these type of orbits are only allowed. So if quantum condition is satisfied in an orbit by an electron, then this orbit is allowed. If this quantum condition is not satisfied, then such orbits are not allowed. So whatever stationary orbit, the concept of stationary orbits which we are discussing right from the beginning, this concept of stationary orbits is connected with this quantum condition, or the quantum condition that the circular orbits for which the angular momentum is equal to n. N is again a principal quantum number here. N is a number, pure natural number, into h cross. And those orbits which are satisfying this relationship, those are only allowed, and electron is allowed to remain in that orbit. Otherwise, other electron won't be allowed to remain in an orbit where this condition is not satisfied. And this is what the second postulate he has taken. So write in wording, word of this, only those circular orbits for electrons are allowed. And remember, this is by nature, this is by no one else. जे कोणाला वाटलं म्हणून असं नाही, नेचर हॅज पुट दिस कंडिशन, अलाउड फॉर विच, ओके, रिमेंबर ऑल दिस थ्री, फॉर विच द अँग्युलर मोमेंटम, ओके, इट इज गिवन बाय आर क्रॉस एम इंटू वी बार, ओके, आर क्रॉस एम वी, और न्यूमेरिकली स्केलर बाय स्केलर रिलेशन, इट इज गिवन बाय m v r. Okay, so scalar, this is a vector relationship I am writing, magnitude of this is going to be m v r, angular momentum capital L bar, okay, is equal to integral multiple of h upon twice pi. This is the statement of the second postulate. only those circular orbits for which electrons are allowed, okay, for which the angular momentum L bar is equal to an integral multiple of h cross. Okay, thus every orbit, stationary orbit, has to satisfy this condition: L bar is equal to m into h upon twice pi. Okay, where m, this n can be only a number, n can be 1, 2, 3, 4, etc., only natural number. This is the actual quantum condition. So this is nothing but quantum condition, Planck's quantum condition. So quantum condition cell tells you that angular momentum is quantized in terms of h cross or h upon twice pi, and angular momentum can take only those values for which this m into h upon twice pi is relationship is valid or is obeyed. So angular momentum can only be into in terms of 1 into h upon twice pi, 2 into h upon twice pi, 3 into h upon twice pi, and so on, 1.5 into h upon twice pi or 3.2 into h upon twice pi. These values of angular momentum are not allowed according to quantum mechanics, and therefore for an electron orbits in an atom, those orbits for which this L is equal to n into h upon twice pi condition is satisfied, those are only stationary orbits, and those orbits are allowed only. This is very, very important and fundamental relationship we must understand. That tells you lot many things. आपल्याला खूप महत्त्वाची माहिती याच्यावर मिळते. सो दिस ऍक्च्युअली बोहर मॉडेल इज अ क्वासी क्वांटम, दॅट मीन्स इट युजेस क्लासिकल कन्सेप्ट एज वेल एज इट युजेस द क्वांटम मेकॅनिकल कन्सेप्ट, अँड दिस कन्सेप्ट इज बिंग यूज हियर. सो अँग्युलर मोमेंटम एल बार इज गिवन बाय एन इंटू एच अपॉन ट्वाइस पाय, ओनली दोज ऑर्बिट्स आर अलाउड. ओके, नाव वी नो दॅट हियर एज आय नो अर्लियर, फॉर सर्क्युलर मोशन okay, you can give number to this relation is 4, okay, number 4. For circular motion, the orbital angular momentum is given by L bar is equal to, okay, I am writing a scalar mv into r. So as I said earlier, it is r cross mv or r cross p, but numerically it is L bar is equal to mvr. Okay, and call this to be equation number 5, and therefore using this equation 4 and 5 we can write the final relation. Therefore equating equation 4 and 5 we get another important condition, that this mvr must be equal to m into h upon twice pi. This is my equation 6. Okay, so those are allowed orbits, or that is what, nothing but stationary orbit. That means if the electron is revolving in this particular orbit, it doesn't radiate, and therefore its energy remains constant, and that's why stationary orbits are possible. Otherwise the orbits in which this type of relationship is not satisfied, not valid, then such type of orbits are never possible in an atom. That is what your second postulate. And now, so try to understand, we have seen first postulate is this: electrons are revolving in a circular or allowed orbits about the nucleus under the action of Coulomb force, and from that I got one relation for this v square is equal to ze square upon 4 pi epsilon 0 m into r. Whereas second postulate gives me this relationship, equation number 6, that is mvr is equal to n is again a quantum number, n is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, etc., into h upon twice pi. Whenever this type of relationship is satisfied, then only this electron is allowed to rotate or revolve in this particular orbits. And now let's go another very important postulate, that is third postulate or assumption. Now what this third assumption is, that as this assumption says that whenever electron goes from lower stationary orbit to higher stationary orbit, it absorbs energy, as well as when it comes from higher stationary orbit to lower stationary orbit, it radiates the energy. So the source of energy in an atom, so energy either radiated or absorbed by atom, that depends upon the location of an electron. So whether it changes its location from lower to higher orbit or from higher to lower orbit, depending upon the energy is absorbed or energy is radiated. And this is again one more quantum condition. So amount of energy radiated or absorbed, that is again a very perfect number, and this is what the third postulate we are going to write here. Okay, so write the statement: a quantum of energy is radiated or given out, radiated only when an electron jumps from higher stationary orbit to lower stationary orbit. So when it changes its orbit from higher to lower, again stationary orbits, then in that case certain amount of energy is released. Okay, lower circuit energy orbit or lower stationary orbit, and frequency of radiation emitted. Frequency of radiation emitted is proportional to the difference between two energy states. Okay, remember, further we are going to call this to be a transition. So transition means electron changes its orbit, it jumps from higher to lower or from lower to higher, and in that transition amount of energy released is proportional to the difference of the energies between these orbits. So orbit 1 and orbit 2, they have this electron has certain energy, and whenever this electron changes the position from first orbit to second orbit, or from second to first, or third to second, and second to one, first, etc., whatever different types of transitions are possible, in that case amount of energy is released from where it came to where, as well as from where it goes from where. So depending upon these type of calculations we can show there, and this is given by here. Okay, so mathematically it is given by, thus h nu, this is the amount of energy released in the form of photons or the electromagnetic radiations. H is Planck's constant, nu is its frequency. It is given by E2 minus E1. E2 is the amount of energy when the electron is in the higher energy state, and when it lowers, it gets it goes to a lower energy state E1. So difference between E2 minus E1 is the amount of energy released in the form of electromagnetic radiations, which is given by, its energy is given by E is equal to H nu. So H nu is equal to E2 minus E1 is another important relation that tells you how these radiations are possible. Okay, so where you can write this, nu is frequency of radiation, and E1 and E2 are energy state. Okay, so when I am coming from, suppose this is E2 and this is E1, so when I am going here down, this certain amount of energy is radiated. This is my photon, which is given by h nu. When this electron goes from this to this, okay, so this transition here is from higher energy to lower energy state, energy is radiated, and from lower energy state to higher energy state, in this case this radiation is absorbed. So this is absorption and this is emissions, and based upon that the spectrum which we are going to define, which is called as absorption spectra and emission spectra as well. So this concept must be known to you earlier. We are just revising all these things here. Okay, therefore Now earlier we have this one relation see this equation number mv square upon r. Okay, so from this relationship, what is this relationship? This equation number 3, of course, we can rearrange this equation. Equation number 3 here, mv square, one of the r can be cancelled, so we can write this from equation number 3. Right, further from equation 3 we can write, from equation 3 we can write 3 of equation earlier to that, we can write m into v square, one of the r is cancelled, so it is 1 upon 4 pi epsilon 0 into z e square upon r. So if I write here to be m square v square, one of the m is increased on the left hand side, so here also I have to add this m in the denominator, and therefore, sorry, numerator, so it is 1 upon 4 pi epsilon 0 into z into e square into small m upon r. Call this equation 8, and look at here, this is m a square v square, and here this is one more equation. Earlier we are having this mvr is equal to n into h upon twice pi, so taking r there it becomes n into h upon twice pi into r, so this m square v square can be written as n square h square upon 4 pi square into 1 upon r square, so this can be written here. So I can use this condition here, therefore this from this is what equation earlier we have written, this mvr is equal to nh of equation 6. From equation 6 we have already, we have written this mv is equal to n into h upon r into twice pi, and therefore m square v square is equal to n square h square upon 4 pi square into r square. This is my equation 9. Now you can equate this equation 8 and 9, because it shows left hand side of both of these equation 8 and 9 are just same, and using that I can find out the relationship as follows. Okay, we have made one mistake there. Okay, m square v square is this, and another m square v square is this. So right, we equate the right hand side of both of this. So equating equations 8 and 9. Equating equations 8 and 9 we get. So this is what earlier equation was, 1 upon 4 pi epsilon 0 into z e square m upon r is equal to n square h square upon 4 pi square into r square. This nothing, I have not done anything, firstly I have taken right hand side of equation 8 and equation 9, they have been adjusted, so this is r, one of the r can be cancelled on both the sides, and here 4 pi is there, there is 4 pi square is also there, so 4 will also get cancelled, and therefore rearranging this equation I'll get equation for radius in the nth orbit, which is given by epsilon 0 into h square divide by, you can go for this calculation, pi m e into square z multiplied by n square. So this r is given to be this. Now this is my equation number 10. So relation for r can be obtained from this equation 8 and 9, which is given by r is equal to epsilon 0 n square h, sorry, n square epsilon 0 h square upon pi m e square into z multiplied by n square. Okay, now as we know that for hydrogen atom z is equal to 1, for hydrogen atom z is equal to 1, so write this, and therefore I'll get relation for nth orbit, r n is equal to epsilon 0 h square, this is constant, pi times m, mass of the electron that is also constant, charge of the electron that is constant, into 1 multiplied by n square. Okay, this is equation 11. and thus here we are calling here N is called as principal quantum number. This N is called as principal quantum number, and it takes values, as I said earlier, only 1, 2, 3, 4, etc. Only natural numbers. Okay, and therefore this above equation shows you radius of nth orbit. Thus, Rn is directly proportional to n square. Rn is directly proportional to n square, where n is equal to 1, 2, 3, 4, and so on. So first orbit, Rn is square right hand. Rn is directly proportional to square of 1, that is 1. Now R2, when I take n equal to 2, it will be 4 times R1. If I take 3, it will be 9 times R1. So that way, as we go on increasing this quantum number n equal to 1, 2, 3, etc. in the our quantum condition, so orbit goes changes, and the radius of that orbit also goes on changing by the proportion of the n square. This is another important result we have written there. Okay, now for radius of first orbit, therefore radius of first orbit for hydrogen atom, that is what we have to put, n is equal to 1, and therefore if I go for this calculation, R1 is equal to epsilon 0 into h square divided by pi into m e square multiplied by n. Everything is known. If these numbers are calculated using that, we get this number to be approximately 0.53 angstrom. So this is the radius of the first orbit of the hydrogen atom, stationary orbit, over which this electron is said to be in the ground state. So this is called as ground state orbit, ground state radius or orbit, stationary orbit, when the electron, this atom, is in the ground state. That's, that means electron is in the first orbit, and therefore its orbit radius from its nucleus, distance of nucleus, is given by 0.53 angstrom. So these calculations can be done there, and also we can obtain, I am not obtaining this relation here, the velocity also you can check. This also, the velocity of an electron in the nth orbit is given by, check, we are not drawing this calculation here, I am not doing this calculation here, which is given by Vn is equal to e square divided by twice epsilon 0 n into h. Planck's constant, this is n is principal quantum number, epsilon 0 is again permittivity of free space. So e square upon twice epsilon 0 into nh, that is the relation number 11 that gives you velocity of the electron in the nth orbit. Now you can check this, you can do it later on. Now that is how these three postulates give you very important information related to the stationary orbit. It also gives why radiations are possible or given out, energy is radiated, and also this has given an expression for calculating this energy in that radiation, as well as we have calculated what is the radius of nth orbit. So stationary orbit, first, second, third, fourth, etc., their radii can be calculated, as we have seen one such example that R1 is equal to 0.53 angstrom. Similarly, we can find out R2 is equal to epsilon 0 n square, epsilon 0 n square upon pi m e square, that is R1, into n square. So n square is now 2 in raised to 4, 2 is 4. So that is 4 times R1 is nothing but R2. So this type of relationships can be obtained, and we can go for later on. Okay, further, we have to go for calculation of energy level and spectra. Energy levels and spectra. Now remember, this is actual application of the Bohr atom model we are going to discuss here. Energy level and spectra. Again, these are very simple calculations. We have to just go for calculation of kinetic energy, then potential energy. Again, I am not doing all these calculations here. We are just writing the expressions for that. Then total energy. Here also the total energy is found to be negative. So that is also a bound state. That means disassociating. That means removing this electron from a hydrogen atom, we have to supply some amount of energy there. Or whenever proton and neutron comes together and hydrogen atom gets formed, then in that case certain amount of energy is released. So energy released in the process, or energy to form the nucleus, the atom, or energy required to break this atom into its constituents, these are same numbers, and this can be calculated as follows. Okay, now one by one we'll do here. The KE, kinetic energy of an electron in the nth orbit is given by, you can calculate this, it is given by T is equal to 1/2 m into velocity in which the orbit, it is vn square, 1/2 mv square. I am using this relation, so using this vn square from the earlier relation, we can get this capital T is equal to m e raised to 4th. Okay, so this v square is there, and divide by 8, because there was earlier 2 into 4 is there, so it is 8 into epsilon 0 square n square into h square. Call this to be equation number 12. So I have used this relation number 11. Okay, vn is equal to e square upon 2 epsilon 0 n into h. So it is vn square will be e raised to 4 upon 4 epsilon 0 square n square h square. So this 4 and earlier 2, that gives you, this 2 gives you 8 epsilon 0 square n square h square in the denominator, while in the numerator it is m into e raised to 4. That is my equation for kinetic energy. Second, the potential energy, the PE, potential energy of an electron. Okay, that is given by capital U, is given by, okay. Suppose this is a nucleus, that is Ze or proton, and this is an electron. So whenever it is at a very long distance, to bring this electron close to this at a distance r in the orbit, how much amount of energy is needed to do this, or amount of energy released when this electron comes from infinity to this location in this potential? So this is given by a very simple expression. In the physics we use this, U is given by amount, this r is the distance we have to approach at the closest distance from infinity, and this is force, attractive force dot dr. So f bar dot dr, integral from r equal to infinity, r is the radius, infinite is the from, that means bringing this electron from infinity to close to this nuclei, or to form this nuclei, how much amount of energy will be there? And this amount of energy is given by nothing but potential energy. So it is given by, so amount of energy, so whatever work done in this process, that is given to be a potential energy. And if it is calculated, this comes to be, again I am just keeping this calculation for you, U is given by minus, so replace this F from the equation 1, electrostatic potential or Coulomb's law, etc., we have used that. This equation comes to be M into e raised to 2 upon 4 epsilon 0 square into n square into h square. This is my equation number 13. Okay, remember we have not calculated this, I have just used the condition that the amount of potential energy in this case is that when this electron is brought from infinity up to a distance r, so what is the work done in this process, which is given by f bar dot dr. And if we replace the value of f from this equation number 1, that is electrostatic force of attraction between this positively charged nucleus and electron, and solving this integration, we will get this expression for energy equal to kinetic energy, U is equal to minus m e raised to 2 upon 4 pi epsilon 0 square n square h square. Note, this is negative in the sense it is again a bound state. Had it been positive, then it would have been a free state, and no condition of the nucleus or the atom would have formed in this case. Okay, so if this is potential and kinetic energies, we can go for the total energy. Therefore, the total energy, therefore total energy of an electron in the nth orbit. Okay, electron, you can check all this, he sagla ekda check karun paha apan lihilele equations barobar ahet ka, how they come. So that is merely mathematics in between, that we are not interested to do here this case. Okay, So is given by enthalpy is given by En is equal to T plus U, kinetic plus potential. Out of that I have just obtained this kinetic is equal to m e raised to 4th upon 8 epsilon 0 square into n square multiplied by h square. This is my kinetic energy, that was equation number 11 I think. Minus, this is now u is now it is plus, but this minus sign is there. So it is m e raised to 4th, sorry, m e raised to 2 divide by this is given by m e square upon 4 epsilon 0 square into n square multiplied by h square, and solving this, okay, here m e raised to 4th, here m e raised to 2, so what that changes there. Okay, it doesn't matter, I just want to show this here. This comes to be m e raised to 4th divide by 8 epsilon 0 raised to 2 into n square multiplied by h square. This is my equation number 14. So this energy of the electron in the nth orbit is given by minus m e 4th upon 8 epsilon 0 square into n square multiplied by h square. Okay, see that numerator, one of the numerator is m e 4th, second numerator is m e square, denominator is 8 epsilon 0 h square n square into h square minus, and this here it is 4 times, second denominator is 4 times epsilon 0 square n square h square. So most of the things are common there except this e square minus m square, and one is 8 and one is 1 by 4. So that using all that calculations, and I'll get if I multiply it by e square, this denominator is, if it is multiplied by e square here, I'll get this particular number to be m e raised to 4th upon 8 epsilon 0 square n square h square. Try to calculate this. I have just given all these numbers directly. So you need to calculate all these things very clear, carefully, then and then it is possible for you to calculate this. So that's how energy level of, this is called as an energy level of the nth electron in the nth orbit, its energy is given by that. So I can write here, energies specified by above equation, this equation by above equation is called energy level. And remember, we have just shown this relation, En is inversely proportional to n square. As n goes on increasing, so 1 upon 1 square, then 1 upon 2 square, 1 upon 3 square, 1 upon 4 square, etc. As these numbers, 1 upon 1 square is 1, 1 upon 2 square is 1 upon 4, 1 upon 3 square is 1 upon 9, 1 upon 4 square is 1 upon 16. So that's how energy of an electron in the higher and higher orbits goes on decreasing. It has maximum energy when it is in the first orbit, n equal to 1, and this kinetic energy or this total energy of the electron goes on decreasing as it goes to higher and higher orbits, and that's why we draw this type of energy levels. So n is equal to 1, then we write this to be n equal to 2, then we write this is n equal to 3, then we write this to be n equal to 4, and that is how this is called as energy levels. So the energy levels goes on changing, and that's why the concept of energy level comes from this derivation or this relation, which is given by En is equal to minus me 4 upon 8 epsilon 0 square n square into h square. Now this relationship is very important for us. Okay, so as I said here, En is inversely proportional to 1 upon n square, and now if I put all this for first orbit, if I calculate this, I'll get a very simple relationship, n is equal to 1, and therefore write all these numbers there, this in this expression number 14, that is En is equal to, so if this En is calculated, this En, okay, write all these numbers, what are these numbers, n is equal to 1, so m is mass of electron, we know the number, e charge of the electron is 4th power 8 epsilon 0 square into h square, h is the Planck's constant and all that. If I go for this calculation, this comes to be, okay, I am not doing actually this thing, but here, this comes to be minus 2.18 into 10 raised to minus 18 joules. And if I divide it by million electron volts, which is 1.6 into 10 raised to minus 13 joules, I get this answer to be minus 13.6 electron volt. So this number is important for me. So for an electron in the first orbit of an atom, its energy is, this is what I am drawing a picture, this is a nucleus Ze, this is an electron in the first orbit, so this is R1, n equal to 1, and this is an electron moving with velocity v, its energy is given by minus 13.6 electron volt. That means this much amount of energy is released when this electron comes close to the proton at a distance of R1 is equal to, which I have already calculated to be 0.53 angstrom. So when this electron is moving around a nucleus at a distance of 0.53 MeV, and in that sense its energy in that stage will be, that is called as the first orbit, and the amount of energy of this bound system will be minus 13.6 electron volts. That is how electron is bounded. So it's a bound state, stable state, and this is what that is shown by this expression for energy. En is equal to minus 13.6 electron volts, and that's why this is also called as binding energy of an electron in the first orbit, providing exactly same amount of energy plus 13.6 electron volts. We can separate out this electron from the atom. In that sense, this amount of energy is called as binding energy of the electron in the first state. As we go for energy states, higher and higher energy levels, this binding energy goes on reducing. That means moving electron in the first orbit, removing electron from the first orbit in hydrogen atom is more energetic as compared to moving electron in the second orbit, third orbit, fourth orbit and so on. And if an electron is at a very high orbit, then it will require a very less amount of energy to remove it from the nucleus. Okay, and therefore we can write in very brief about this, because there can be several questions over this binding energy and all that. Thus, write one very important statement. Okay, whatever we are writing here, the questions will be only based upon that. That's why for convenience and for simplicity, we have tried all these things. Thus, 13.6 electron volt, energy is required to remove electron from the first orbit of hydrogen atom. This much is the amount of energy required to remove the electron from the first orbit of the hydrogen atom, and this why this is called as the binding energy. This is called as binding, B-I-N-D-I-N-G, binding energy of an electron for first orbit. Of electron in first orbit. So this is called as binding energy of an electron in the first orbit. Okay, and this is the minimum energy state of an electron. Another important statement. This is the minimum energy state of an electron. This is the minimum energy state of an electron. And that's why this state is called as ground state. This state is, okay, state means n is equal to 1. First ground or first quantum number is used here. This state n is equal to 1 is called as ground state of an hydrogen atom. Called ground state of hydrogen atom. So when electron is observed in the first energy state or first stationary orbit, n is equal to 1. Its radius of that orbit is given by 0.53 angstrom. Its energy is given by minus 13.6 electron volt. and this is called as ground state of an hydrogen atom. Okay, and as for further, in the subsequent orbits, energy En is given by a very simple relationship I can show here. This energy of the electron in the nth orbit is given by, for the first it is minus 13.6 divided by n square. So using this simple calculation I can calculate how much is the amount of energy in the second state, in the third state, in the fourth state, in the fifth state, etc. So when I put n is equal to 2, it is minus 13.6 upon 4, so somewhere around 3. Then if I use a third orbit, that is n equal to 3, then it is minus 13.6 upon 9, still smaller than E2. Minus 13.6 upon 16 in the fourth, still smaller than third, and so on. And that's how energy goes on decreasing as we go to the higher and higher energy state. Okay. So this binding energy goes on decreasing, means total energy of an electron increases as it goes to higher and higher energy state. So we will write here one statement. So this is what I am getting, the energy of the difference. So this is how Bohr theory could successfully given you how to calculate radius, how to calculate energy, how to calculate kinetic potential energy of an hydrogen atom, assuming that this electron is revolving in a stationary orbit, and what are the, these three postulates. With the help of these three postulates, we could explain each and every property of the hydrogen atom. Now, we have to go next important aspect here is origin of spectra. So that is the understanding of the spectra by this Bohr atom model. That is what we are going to discuss here. Origin of the spectra. Still half an hour, so we'll just complete this. Origin of the spectra. According to third postulate, the energy radiated is given by, I'll just write this as h nu is equal to En minus Em. Okay. So I am calling N to be initial state. M to be initial state. And N is final state. So when the electron comes from initial state to final state, the difference between these energies is nothing but the amount of energy energy radiated, or that is the amount of energy of that photons, which is given by h nu is equal to En minus Em. Okay, or we can call En is the amount of energy of that electron in the nth orbit, and this is the amount of energy of electron in the mth orbit. So who is bigger, n is bigger than m or n is bigger than n, depending upon that this will be positive or negative, and so on. So if it is positive, then there is an emission. If it is a negative, then there is an absorption. So we can understand this later on. Okay. Now if I use now this expression for En is used for that, I can get, therefore the equation can be rewritten as. Okay, use this En as well as Em from earlier relation for energy. That relation was, we had already calculated, En is equal to m into e raised to 4 upon 8 epsilon 0 square n square into h square. Now second quantum number, that is m is mass of electron. Here m is the number. So Em is equal to eigen minus me into e raised to 4 upon 8 epsilon 0 square m square into h square. So using this, I'll get h nu is equal to, okay, write this Em first. Your En pahila nalya. So it is m minus m into e raised to 4 upon 8 epsilon 0 square h square into n square minus, okay, now this is minus here, so minus this is given by m into e raised to 4, okay, negative sign, डिवाइड बाय 8 एप्सिलॉन 0 एच स्क्वेयर एंड एम स्क्वेयर. रिमेंबर दिस एम इज मास, एम ई मास ऑफ द इलेक्ट्रॉन, दिस एम इज द क्वांटम नंबर. सो ट्राई टू अंडरस्टैंड दिस डिफरेंस, डोंट कैंसिल दिस. सो 8 एप्सिलॉन 0 एच स्क्वेयर एंड दिस, ओके, दैट इज. सो कॉमन थिंग इज हियर m into e raised to 4th upon 8 epsilon 0 square, h square is common. Now this is negative, this is minus, minus becomes positive. So I can write here to be m e raised to 4th, m e e raised to 4th upon 8 epsilon 0 h square into m square minus, this is m e into e raised to 4th upon 8 epsilon 0 square h square into n square, and therefore this can be written as further. We can write, and I can write here m e h nu can be written there, and therefore it is h nu is equal, okay, I can write here it is m e raised to 4th upon 8 epsilon 0 square h square into the bracket 1 upon m square minus 1 upon n square, and taking this h here, this is h nu. I'll get the relation for frequency of the radiation emitted is given by m e raised to 4th upon 8 epsilon 0 square h cube this time. So h comes here, earlier h square is there, so it becomes h cube into the bracket 1 upon m square minus 1 upon n square. This is n. Sorry. N square. And call this to be equation number 15. That gives you amount of energy released. Okay, and but according to electromagnetic theory, we know the relationship between that is velocity of the light radiation, its frequency and wavelength. Okay, but according to EM theory, electromagnetic theory, we have this relationship: C is equal to nu times lambda. This is wavelength, this is the speed or velocity, and this is nothing but nu. Nu is frequency. So frequency is equal to C equal to nu lambda, that is the relationship for this. So I can write nu is equal to C upon lambda, and therefore, and taking this C on the right hand side, I'll get 1 upon lambda is equal to, replace this there, this nu is equal to C upon lambda, so I'll get relation for 1 upon lambda is equal to, C will come here, so it is m into e raised to 4 upon 8 epsilon 0 square h cube into C, okay, substituting that, and multiplied by 1 upon m square minus 1 upon n square, okay, this is 1 upon n square, and here, this quantity on the left hand side here, this 1 upon lambda is called as reciprocal of wavelength, or that is called as wave number, wave number, and which is given by nu bar, okay, symbol for use for this nu bar, and therefore I can write a very simple relationship, because in spectroscopy we do not measure usually the wavelength, we measure this wave number, and therefore wave number nu bar is given to be, now here this m e raised to 4th upon 8 epsilon 0 square h cube c etc, everything is constant here, and that's why this is called as a constant r or Rydberg constant. So 1 upon m square minus 1 upon n square, okay, here this r is called as Rydberg constant, Rydberg, Rydberg's constant, Rydberg constant, and value of this if it is calculated, which is given by R is equal to, if it is calculated, so put all the numbers, mass of the electron, its charge, 4th power, 8 epsilon 0 square, then this speed of the light, 3 into 10 to 8 meters per second, and H is the Planck's constant, its 3rd power is to be taken, in the entire calculation is done, 1.097 into 10 raised to 7 meters per meter. This is the wave number here. Remember, this is a number. This is number, so R is also going to be a number, and it has dimensions. This is per meter. That is the dimensions of this. So R is equal to this. And remember, दिस इज वॉट ए प्रैक्टिकल वैल्यू इज एग्जैक्टली सेम. सो थियोरटिकल वैल्यू प्रेडिक्टेड और द प्रैक्टिकल वैल्यू मेजर्ड बाई एक्सपेरिमेंटिस एंड द थियोरटिकल वैल्यू प्रेडिक्टेड बाई दिस बोर मॉडल दैट वेर एग्जैक्टली सिमिलर. ओके सो रेडबर्ग कॉन्स्टेंट इज गिवन बाय दिस. सो दस राइट हियर दस द प्रैक्टिकल वैल्यू ऑफ रेडबर्ग कॉन्स्टेंट is predicted by Bohr atom model. This is predicted by Bohr model. So Bohr predicted this, and based upon that we can go for different energy states and so on. So you might have drawn this diagram earlier, so we'll just write the energy level diagram and we'll go for its simple explanation as follows. Okay, so draw this energy level diagram here. I'm drawing this to be a ground state, n is equal to 1. Then the energy of the second state is given by n is equal to 2. Then this is n is equal to 3. This energy goes on reducing as n goes increasing. Then this is n equal to 4. N equal to 5, still close to this. N equal to 6, again close to this. So you can go for these calculations and that shows you this N equal to 7 and so on. So whatever transition, now if I go for its values of the calculation of energy, it is minus 13.6 electron volt. Then this is minus 3.40 electron volt. So divide it by 4, I'll get this. If it is divided by 9, I'll get minus 0.51 electron volt. Then there is something missing here. You can go for these calculations. It is 0.91. Then this is minus 0.85 electron volt, this one. Then it is minus 0.54 electron volts on this one, like this. And that's how, that's as I go here, if this goes to be n equal to infinity, then this value is almost zero. So electron at infinite orbit, its energy is simply equal to zero because it is free. And as it's moved from high infinite orbit to lower orbit up to n equal to 1, then its energy goes on reducing and that becomes increasing. Binding energy goes on increasing and it becomes 13.6 electron volts and so on. Okay. Now I am showing this first transition from n equal to 2 to n equal to 1. This is my first transition. Similarly, from this to this, from n equal to 4 to n equal to 1, then from n equal to 5 to n equal to 1, all this. This is called as Lyman series. Lyman introduced this series, so it is Lyman series. Then for this, so this is to this, first, second transition, third transition, fourth transition, maybe fifth transitions, and etc. So this is called as Balmer series. Actually, this is called as H alpha, H beta, H gamma, H delta, etc. And this is Balmer series, B-A-L-M-E-R, Balmer series. So these are the spectral lines emitted or observed in the Balmer series. And remember, this is the visible spectrum. This is the visible spectrum. Whereas this is ultraviolet, this is visible. And here also, I can go for further steps. I'm not able to show everything here, but you can go for this. And that shows. So this is third series observed. And this is your Paschen series. And remaining, that bracket and fund for n equal to 4, transition from 5, 6, 7, 8, etc. up to 4, that is bracket series, and for last one, that is from 6, 7, 8, etc. up to n equal to 5, that is called as fund series. So this is called as energy level diagram for hydrogen atom, and its explanation was given by Bohr model on the basis of this following. Okay, so first, Lyman series. We have not drawn the correct diagram here, but we can understand how this is comes there. Lyman series. Transition from के n इक्वल टू 2, 3, 4, 2, m इक्वल टू 1, दिस इज फाइनल, सॉरी दिस इज फाइनल, m इज फाइनल एंड n इज इनिशियल, इनिशियल एंड दिस इज फाइनल स्टेट, एनर्जी स्टेट. सो व्हेन वी गो फॉर दिस वी गेट दिस टू बी ए लाइमन सीरीज. एंड रिमेंबर वेवलेंथ ऑफ स्पेक्ट्रल लाइंस इन दिस सीरीज, वेवलेंथ ऑफ स्पेक्ट्रल लाइंस इन लाइमन सीरीज, LYMAN, लाइमन सीरीज lies in the ultraviolet region, ultraviolet region of electromagnetic spectrum. This is first calculation that shows you. Now second is Balmer series. It is observed for n equal to 3, 4, 5 and so on, and m is equal to 2. Okay, so H alpha, okay, these are very important line for here. This line gives you for H alpha, we have n is equal to 3 and m is equal to 2. H beta, this is n is equal to 4 and m is equal to 2. H gamma, this is n equal to 5 and m is equal to 2. And then H delta, etc. N is equal to 6, transition from n equal to 6 to m is equal to 2. This transition is shown here. Okay, actually I am using ether diagram madhe mi kutai m dakhol nahi, but m I am taking to be final state and n I am taking to be initial states. In that sense I have used that. And remember, all these are, okay, this is from the visible spectrum. So the light which we observe from the sun, which is having this type of spectral lines there. So all the lines are found in Balmer series, because the sun consists of large number of hydrogen atoms and the spectrum of hydrogen atom is this. So radiations which are getting from the sun are basically these visible radiations. Tell us upon put on Fraunhofer lines. So this RH alpha, H beta, H gamma, etc. are the dominant lines, and these lines are respectively transitions are shown as there. And these transitions give rise to this type of radiations here. So all this is called as Balmer series. So first is Lyman, second is Balmer, third is Paschen series. And here we have n is equal to 4, 5, 6, etc. m is equal to 3. This is the initial final state is 3. And this lies in the infrared region of electromagnetic spectrum. So energy of these radiations is less as compared to Balmer. Balmer is less as compared to first, that is the Lyman series. Lyman series is more energetic. Balmer is less than that. That is visible. This Paschen is still less energetic. So it lies in the infrared region. And fourth series is the Brackett. These are the name of the scientist, Brackett series. And here we have n equal to 5, 6, 7, etc. m is equal to 4. So it's again far infrared region. This is in the far infrared region. And 5, this is Pfund series. So here n is equal to 5, 6, 7 and so on, 6, 7, 8 and so on, and m is equal to 5, and this is again far infrared. So this is less energetic. Sagyat kami energy yachi asel, tyachyanantar jast energy ase asel, this and Lyman series will be highest energetic. So this particular type of spectral wavelength calculated. Okay, so remember, these wavelengths were known, these regions were known, these series were known, their numbers, that means their wave numbers as well as wavelength, etc., etc., is known in the spectroscopy, but its origin was not known. So from where these type of spectral lines comes, this origin of spectral lines was not known at that time, and this could be possible. People could understand origin of this spectrum of hydrogen atom on this 5 series, because these transitions takes place where these transitions are nothing but which are being used by this Bohr theory to understand the concept of the structure of the atom. So here the concept of this particular stationary orbits and the transition from higher orbit to lower orbit as shown here, that supports you very nicely, and that's what the successful explanation of the spectrum or origin of spectrum is given by the Bohr theory. Okay, so we'll write here, this is the good success of Bohr's theory, Bohr's model. Okay, that it predicted, you can write here, it predicted the all spectral lines observed in all 5 series. This is the success. Okay, to limited extent, but at the same time, okay, in the last 1 or 2 minutes we'll go for, just we'll write this, there are certain limitations of this model, limitations of Bohr model. This is also very important from the examination point of view. One or two limitations I may ask here. First one, very common, it cannot explain relative intensities of spectral line. Okay, some spectral lines are very sharp, very highly, that energy of that is that means the intensity of that spectral line is very high, whereas some lines are very weak in the sense their energy density is much less or the intensity is much less. So why this happens? Actually each and every line should have same intensity, but this is not predicted by this Bohr model. So this is its first limitation. Second, it cannot explain spectra of two or more atoms. That means if more than one electron is there in an atom, then its spectra, predicted spectra and Bohr theory spectra and actual observed spectrum in the spectroscopy, they are different. So it cannot explain the spectra of two or more electrons. So for one electron, this Bohr atom is very very successful, Bohr atom model is very very successful, but for 2, 3, 4 etc, if the number of electrons are there, then this model cannot explain everything here. Okay, and there is one more very interesting concept here. This is called as, it cannot give the details of fine structure. It cannot give details of fine structure of spectral line. I am sure not many of maybe knowing what is by fine structure, what it is, what it should be, and what actual this theory is. So why Bohr model could not explain this particular fine structure? So what this fine structure means? Fine structure manje kay asto ki ekadi spectral line doublet diste, ekadi triplet diste, very close to each other these lines are observed. And actual theory predicts one line, but in sometimes we observe 2, 3 lines for a single transition. And this particular fine structure, why this type of fine structure existing in case of spectrum, this also could not be explained by this particular theory. So more about this fine structure etc. and another model that is called as Bohr-Sommerfeld model, modified model, that will be discussed in the next lecture or tomorrow. Okay, so today we'll stop here.